out where they say, let us be gay, I'm going Hollywood.
Bing Crosby, the channeled Scablands, and throw in the Sunset Highway. Is that really the title of tonight's talk? That seems crazy. Do we know anything about any of those things? Bing Crosby, who is that? Sunset Highway, where was that? What is that? The channeled Scablands, something to do with Washington, not sure what that is either. It dawned on me this morning, and I've been working on this lecture kind of in my mind for weeks, dawned on me this morning that anybody over the age of, under the age of 40 is not going to know who Bing Crosby was. So I took a poll this morning in my class up at the college. I said, who's Bing Crosby? Anybody know that name? And I wasn't going to accept that, so I dug a little deeper. I said, no, come on. Who is Bing Crosby? And a kid says, black trumpet player. I'm not kidding. And kind of cocky, like, you know, duh, of course, black trumpet player. Another student says, no, Bing Crosby was a geologist who told about the Ice Age floods, and nobody believed him, and then he lived long enough where he was finally accepted, and it was a great story at the end. So let's be real clear right up front. Anybody who is young in the room, Bing Crosby was not black. He was not a trumpet player. He was not a geologist. Bing Crosby had nothing to do with the geology that I'm going to teach tonight. But there is a way we can tie Bing Crosby, the Sunset Highway, and the channeled Scablands. You just got to give me a chance. I can do it. Now, the Sunset Highway, that's a focal point of tonight. And so this is going to be a different lecture than usual. This is not a traditional geology lecture by any means. The Sunset Highway, I mean, just think about that. They know how to name roads back in the day, you know? Where's the Sunset? Get me on the Sunset Highway. That sounds like a great place to be. But there was also the Inland Empire Highway and the Yellowstone Trail. These are romantic-sounding names, and they were roads in the state of Washington before the Great Depression. And oh, it kind of bothered me. I never really knew. I've heard those places, but I never had it figured out. So last summer, I had a little time. I dug in and did some learning, and I want to share some of that with you tonight. There will be some geology, but I'm going to tie it to the Sunset Highway and ultimately to Bing Crosby, who wasn't young people. He was an entertainer. He was a singer. He was a jazz singer. He was in TV movies, a great worldwide celebrity for a long time. Okay, quick story before we begin to get us into the Sunset Highway. I moved to Ellensburg, Washington in 1992, and that's starting to feel like a long time ago. That was before the internet, young people. That was before the 1992. So we were excited. We just moved. We'd never lived in Washington before. We wanted to learn as much as we could about Washington in short order. And I remember going to the university library and checking out books. That's how you got information back then. And my idea was I was going to find some biographies and some autobiographies of famous people who grew up in Washington. And that would be a way that I could learn in kind of a unique way. So I don't remember most of those biographies that I read back then. Maybe the William O. Douglas book about growing up in Yakima, for instance. But the one that I really remember was the biography of Bing Crosby. One page in particular, I can still remember where I was sitting when I read that page, and it went something like this. In October of 1925, Bing Crosby and his childhood buddy from Spokane, Washington, Al Rinker, jumped in an old Model T Ford, no top, open car, threw Bing's drums in the back seat of that Model T, and drove to Hollywood. October of 1925. But the thing that really hooked me, that got me, one sentence in that book in 1992, I can still clearly remember. And the sentence said, they didn't drive straight to Hollywood. Their first stop was Seattle, Washington. So they drove, it was a Thursday. Thursday, October 15th, 1925, they drove from Spokane, Washington to Seattle, Washington. And I thought, wait a minute, this is my new town, Ellensburg. And Bing Crosby must have been driving right through Ellensburg in 1925, right down 8th Avenue, right in front of Central. And I was new, and I was meeting people, and if it was a kind of an awkward social situation, I would I would launch into my Bing Crosby story. That was my go-to. Did you know that in 1925, Bing Crosby and a Model T would drive? Here's the punchline. I found out last summer my story was wrong. Bing Crosby and Al Rinker never came through Ellensburg in 1925. They came on the Sunset Highway, which I assumed went through Ellensburg, but it did not. So where did the Sunset Highway run? Can we follow Bing and Al from Spokane to Seattle? Can we learn some geology along the way? That's the gimmick for the lecture. So let's get started. So we got to go back before Bing's trip, 1913. 1912, 1913. The state of Washington says, we're going to build some new roads for these new things called automobiles, and we're going to make some primary highways. The first one we're going to build is the Pacific Highway, which is going to run from Bellingham down to Portland, Oregon. Puget Lowland, pretty flat, no major obstacles. Today it's Interstate 5. Okay, moving on. That's not our topic tonight. The second road that was built was the Sunset Highway. Sunset Highway, connecting Seattle with Spokane, or vice versa in Bing's case. Okay, so we got to get this Sunset Highway in 1912 over the Cascades. Well, Snoqualmie Pass was the obvious choice. There was some traffic over Snoqualmie Pass back in the day. So we can do that. We can use that old road, that old wagon road. We can improve it and make it the Sunset Highway, which officially opened in 1915, by the way. So we can get to Cle Elum, no problem. There was an obstacle. This is the Columbia River, if you're not familiar with Washington geography, right? This is a river. This is the Columbia River coming out of Canada, working its way down through eastern Washington, and then the Columbia River Gorge making the state line between Washington and Oregon. The Sunset Highway had to cross the Columbia River, and there was only one bridge at the time in Wenatchee, built in 1908. It's a black bridge. It's still there. Old bridge, you can't drive it anymore, you can walk it or bicycle across it. So somehow this Sunset Highway that was built had to get from Cle Elum to Wenatchee. That was the only way to cross the Columbia back in the day. Okay, so surveyors were sent out. We're going to send the Sunset Highway to Ellensburg, and then we're going to go up and over Kalakum Pass. A reaction from the audience. These are mostly local people. They know Kalakum Pass. That's the ridge to the northeast of Ellensburg, the ridge to the north. There were surveyors up there. They were starting to work on this new highway that was going to make a direct shot from the Kittitas Valley, Ellensburg, Washington, right over to Wenatchee. 1913, work was in progress. Word got out about this plan. The U.S. Forest Service said, look, you don't have to make a road from scratch. We've got a road over Blewett Pass. There's been gold mining up there for a few decades. Just take that old wagon road up by Liberty, improve it, improve the grade. We can get some cars up and over old Blewett, and you'll be good. And that's what happened. They abandoned the Kalakum Pass plan. They abandoned the Ellensburg location, and they shot through Lauderdale Junction. They went up Liberty, they went up over Blewett Pass, drop into Dryden, drop into Cashmere, get us to Wenatchee. Let's continue. We build the Sunset Highway. We cross at Wenatchee up to Orondo, Waterville, cross the Waterville Plateau, cross through Moses Coulee, drop to Coulee City. That's the Grand Coulee. Dry Falls is within eyesight of the old Sunset Highway. Let's continue. Elmira, Wilbur, Creston, Davenport, Reardon, Spokane. Many of you know that drive. That's US 2 today, but that was the old Sunset Highway back in the day. Now that's the Sunset Highway. The Inland Empire Highway came next. The next big bridge across the Columbia River was down at Kennewick, built in 1922. So now we've got a second primary road on eastern Washington's side. The only two places where the Inland Empire and the Sunset Highway intersected was Spokane and Lauderdale Junction, which today is nothing, just north of Ellensburg. There's hardly anything there. Back in the day, it was a major junction. And so to draw the Inland Empire Highway, we go from Lauderdale Junction to Ellensburg, where you are located right now, up and over the old Durr Road, Yakima, Sunnyside, Prosser, Benton City, Kennewick, Cross at Kennewick, Pasco, Walla Walla, Dayton, Rosalia. Oh, hell, I'm in Idaho here. Hang on. Spokane, keep going. Chihuahua, Colville. And in 1929, a bridge was finally put in at Kettle Falls. And we're going to take the Inland Empire Highway to the Canadian border. So the Sunset Highway was the main drag before the Depression between Seattle and Spokane. The Inland Empire Highway connected the best it could all the rest of these communities in eastern Washington. This was all promoted by Chamber of Commerce. These are all local folks maintaining their section of the road to try to keep this thing going. Now, the Yellowstone Trail is also part of this story, but that's using these existing routes. The Yellowstone Trail was a national road. The slogan for the Yellowstone Trail was Plymouth Rock to the Puget Sound. And we're promoting cross-country travel by automobile in the 19-teens and 20s. And that was a single road for most of the stretch, but once you got to Washington, before 1925, it was the Inland Empire that was promoted. But at 1925, there were improvements to the Sunset Highway, and so there was a preferred route to take the Sunset Highway on the Yellowstone Trail instead of down here at the Inland Empire. Eventually, this Yellowstone Trail crosses as well. I've got a bunch of maps, a bunch of photos, a bunch of everything. So when Bing and Al, October 1925, they took the Sunset Highway, they did not come through Ellensburg. You might be curious about Vantage. Vantage today, of course, is the location where we're actually doing this traveling. The bridge at Vantage was put in 1927. 2 years after Bing's trip. Now, there was a ferry system at the time, during Bing's time, 1925, they would ferry your car across the river, but if this was a well-maintained road, paved in sections, Bing and Al took that, didn't come through Ellensburg. So eventually we bring the Frenchman Cooley into this when we finally get the bridge going at Vantage. Okay, we'll visit more of that with the visuals, a bunch of kind of old photos matched with modern photos will follow Bing and Al traveling across the state. But some of you came for geology and you're thoroughly confused at the moment. What? Guy burned up 15 minutes talking about something nothing to do with geology. Well, that's the title hopefully gave it away that we're not doing nothing. We're doing more than just basic geology. So let's keep this map. Let's get rid of the roads. And let's go to the Ice Age now. Let's go to the Ice Age. Let's get rid of Seattle. Feels good. No offense. So Wenatchee is still here. You know what? Let's put Seattle back. I felt bad about that. But there's another reason we'll keep Seattle as well. So during the Ice Age, hopefully you know what I mean. We're talking about the last 2.5 million years worth of time, long before Bing Crosby. Okay? And we're going to talk about what Washington looked like during many times during the Ice Age. Ice, of course. There was an ice sheet, a thick ice sheet that extended from the North Pole over Canada and crept far south into Washington. So Seattle was under 3,000 feet of glacial ice many times during the Ice Age. There was another lobe of this ice and another lobe. So I got some white chalk. Let's do that. So this is all ice, thick ice, part of the ice sheet, continuous with the major ice sheet covering most of North America, north of our latitude. Okay? And we've got these individual lobes. This is an important lobe for us, the Okanagan lobe, and over here in northern Idaho, the Purcell Trench lobe. Okay, good. So we're launching into something related to the Ice Age floods, which is floods of water, and I want to do something with Glacial Lake Columbia, which I usually ignore in all of my teaching of the Ice Age floods. I ignore Glacial Lake Columbia. Never really knew what to do with it. I'm still not totally sure what to do with it, but at least I know enough now to understand that Glacial Lake Columbia is an important part of the Ice Age flood story, and I predict that there will be some new information coming from the Ice Age floods from the study of the floor of that old Glacial Lake Columbia. So I think that might be a hot spot in the next 20, 30 years of research to help us better understand the timing of these Ice Age floods. Okay, but let's still do some basic stuff, assuming you haven't heard this at all. I'll just make it real quick. I know many of you have heard this story. So when we had this ice sheet in place, Over here in Montana, water was trapped. Water couldn't leave the valleys of western Montana because of this ice sheet that was sitting over northern Idaho. So the Clark Fork River drainage system was blocked, and we had a big bathtub full of icy cold water just sitting there above Missoula, Montana, and other valleys. Finally, there's enough water to release through this broken Purcell trench lobe. We bust up this ice lobe. We actually have broken pieces of the glacial ice sheet in the water. So not only is this 70 mile an hour water coming across eastern Washington, it's got big blocks of ice in it. And the blocks of ice sometimes are carrying big boulders, ice rafted erratics. So normally, as I've presented it and others have presented it, this is just water cruising over dry land. And all of the glory of all these dramatic erosional pieces, that's what the channeled Scablands is, these places where the Ice Age floods did this carving. Here's a new wrinkle. Some of the Missoula floods did not enter Washington over dry land. There was a big bathtub in northern Washington that sat, I got to put another river in here now. Let's put in this Spokane River. You've been to downtown Spokane, there's a river coming right through town, right? That's the Spokane River that's eventually going to merge with the Columbia River. And this Columbia is going to work its way to the ocean. So Spokane and Columbia Rivers. In cross-section, we want to picture that both the Spokane River and the Columbia Rivers are V-shaped valleys, V-shaped canyons, carved by the rivers themselves. But what I'm saying is that many times that we had Glacial Lake Missoula, at the same time we had Glacial Lake Columbia, which was water sitting in the Columbia River Valley and the Spokane River Valley. Why was it sitting there? Washington had an ice dam as well. This Okanagan lobe, you'll notice, advanced right over the top of the Columbia River. So the water in these two rivers could not get out. So what I can do for you, and this will be better with the professional maps that are coming, this is a typical scene of the maximum size of Glacial Lake Columbia. Glacial Lake Columbia, not Glacial Lake Missoula, that's the one in Montana. Ours is Glacial Lake Columbia. And my major point that I want to impart before we go to the images is that when we have a big Missoula flood cross into Washington, that water is plowing into a lake that's already sitting there. Spokane, have you ever thought of this? Spokane is in a valley that had the most energetic water imaginable in this Ice Age flood story. And yet Spokane itself does not sit in a huge coulee or a huge Dry Falls cataract system. It never dawned on me till recently. Why is Spokane in a valley that doesn't have the look of massive Ice Age flood erosion since there was such energetic water coming through? Here's the answer. The lake water, Glacial Lake Columbia, protected Spokane and from all the brunt of that energetic water. This water slammed into this lake, displaced a bunch of water, so we did have massive Ice Age flood erosion. But it was to the south. It was to the south. Think of this bathtub, this Glacial Lake Columbia bathtub, as getting a bunch of water dumped into the tub. There's way too much water for the tub to handle. And on the south rim of Glacial Lake Columbia, this water is being displaced. It's spilling over the southern margin of the Glacial Lake shoreline. And we have the Grand Coulee, Dry Falls. We have a Telford Crab Creek section, you'll see in the images, not as impressive. And we've got a major flood path from Cheney down to Palouse Falls. So the role of Glacial Lake Columbia, first of all, is shunting some of the, or absorbing the energy of this high velocity water. And we're getting these major floods by water leaking out of the southern side of Glacial Lake Columbia. That's significant. The second significant reason for including Glacial Lake Columbia tonight is that there are beautiful deposits where this lake used to be. In other words, at the bottom of the lake during the Ice Age, there were repetitive layers of silt and clay and sometimes some gravel lenses. that have been carefully studied. And there are new ways to study these glacial Lake Columbia sediments. I'll show you photos. I think it's those sediments that are tough to get to, by the way. This is all, by the way, we've got a dam today, don't we? We have this ice dam is gone, but we've got Grand Coulee Dam, which is damming up the Columbia River today. That's Lake Roosevelt. What's Lake Roosevelt? It's just the dammed Columbia River. So we had an ice age dam and lake. We have a, today we have a dam and a lake. But the point is, it's tough to get to these sediments. You need a boat to go up Lake Roosevelt to get to these locations. You can't just take easy hikes to many of these places. So logistics is an issue, but I think there'll be some new dates, and there are some new dates coming. A paper published just this year, 2016, from a couple of Canadian geologists have a new date. They've got a date 13,400 years ago for one particular layer at the bottom of Glacial Lake Columbia, and they have 37 Missoula floods sitting on top of that date. Let me say that again. So we've got a layer that was deposited at the bottom of Glacial Lake Columbia that's been dated at 13,400 years ago, and sitting on top of that, in other words, deposited after or younger than 13,400, are 37 rhythmically deposited sediments. Does that mean we have 37 major floods coming from Montana? Are these 37 minor floods coming from Montana? These kinds of basic questions remain. And if you've heard the Ice Age flood story and you've heard some dates associated with them, it's not an accident the dates are fuzzy and the dates are inconsistent. The dates aren't nailed down yet. I'm hoping before I retire in a couple decades that we'll have a bunch more detailed dates for individual events. But it's starting to look like, if you're up on this Ice Age flood story, that a lot of these very delicate, rhythmically deposited sediments are minor. They're almost afterthoughts to the major drama. It looks like major coulees were carved earlier in the Ice Age, hundreds of thousands of years ago, instead of in this time frame. But it's tough to get specific dates for that, but there's field evidence to suggest that the major coulee carvers were the big boys long before this kind of story. So I'm going to keep putting question marks until we can kind of nail some of this down. Why am I tying this? How can I tie this to the Sunset Highway? Here's how, and this is the last thing we'll do before we go to this cavalcade of video clips and photographs and maps and even Bing Crosby performing for you. No, the black trumpeter. Yeah, you'll get that all. Old Satchmo is going to perform. Right. Bing and Al traveling the Sunset Highway. The Sunset Highway is a convenient landmark for us. The ice sheet never got south of the Sunset Highway. In fact, the ice sheet got precisely to the Sunset Highway, just west of Coulee City. So U.S. Highway 2 today, the Sunset Highway back in the day, that's one reason that we can use the Sunset Highway. Ice never got further south than the Sunset Highway. Also, our Glacial Lake Columbia is also just north of the Sunset Highway. The only place that Glacial Lake Columbia, still bathtub water, got to the Sunset Highway was right in the Spokane area. And you'll see some maps. Glacial Lake Columbia backed up at times into Idaho, almost back to Glacial Lake Missoula. The only separating these two glacial lakes was Lookout Pass. So this is a significant part of the story. I admit that I ignored it to this point, but I'm seeing the promise in digging into the details of Glacial Lake Columbia, and hopefully you'll see that too. So we have these beautiful images today of the state of Washington, and Dry Falls is right in the middle of no man's land out here, but we're going to bring that out to you. We're going to be a little bit more careful. Of course, today we've got interstates. We've got Interstate 90, 82, Interstate 5, but back in the day, young people, the interstates were built in the 1960s. We go back early to the 1960s, we've got these old roads. The river itself, the Columbia River, have you ever noticed the Columbia River comes to the south and then it swings crazily to the west? And this was noticed long ago, decades ago, and this is a hypothetical for what the Columbia River perhaps looked like millions of years ago, a straight shot to the Tri-Cities, but something caused it to get pushed to the west. The basalt lavas themselves, this is back millions of years ago now, long before the Ice Age, and certainly long before Bing and Al. These lavas flooded inland northwest and pushed the Columbia River to its current course. And there's other little samplers here I just want to throw out and areas that I'm working on. The Columbia River basalt lavas were fed by these deep fissures. Most of you have heard this story. Deep cracks that were fed by lava. So those are igneous dikes from below. But if you get that material to the surface, there's a wall of fire, essentially. These are spatters of lava that are flowing to the air and falling to the ground. Well, up until recently, I didn't realize that a few of those fissures, those dikes, extend all the way up to the Sunset Highway. They're not just in extreme southeastern Washington. This is a Steve Rydell map. The Ginkgo Flow, the Rosa Flow, and the Priest Rapids Flows, three of the significant lava flows in central Washington, came out of cracks, dikes, that can be followed deeply into central Washington. The exciting part for me is that this past fall, I mean, this could be the Sunset Highway. There's still roads like this in Washington. They're still pretty remote. It's great. And going out there and exploring, I got a tip that not only is there an igneous dike for one of the flows, the Rosa Flow, not only is there that dike out there, but there's actual spatter. There's actual places where the lava, a Columbia River basalt lava, 15 million years ago, you could see where the spatter was flying through the air and falling on the ground. This is very new to me and maybe to you as well. So I need to work with this a little bit more, but to have an actual fissure that has aerial spatter was exciting. This also was exciting. This is right close to downtown Spokane. These are pillow lavas where the lava was flowing into water. So the Spokane area has all sorts of wonderful bedrock geology, and we're not talking about the basalts tonight, but Spokane has the same Columbia River basalt lavas generally that we do here in the Kittitas Valley. One final bedrock map. This is just a fold in the old geologic map on my desk. Here's Spokane. Here's Bing and Al traveling on the Sunset Highway. But this is a bedrock map. So all the brown is this Columbia River basalt lava. So another reason to get interested in this area just to the north of the Sunset Highway is the basalts peter out, and we're into these much older rocks that tell stories of the state of Washington getting assembled piece by piece. And there's a few geologists who love these rocks and are bored by the basalts, and so they actively joke that this big basalt pile is just like a big cow pie sitting in eastern Washington. So here's that cow pie. Here are these dikes, these feeder dikes that all have the same orientation, by the way. But now we're transitioning to our ice. Puget Lobe, Okanagan Lobe, Purcell Trench Lobe. And yes, this is the star of the show normally, the Glacial Lake Missoula scene, but it's this area that we're focusing on tonight. So if you look at a NOVA special, water in Montana, break through the ice dam, no water here, that's the simple way to tell the story. But we know better now tonight. Let's slow down and look carefully at this. So this darker blue is Glacial Lake Missoula. This lighter blue is our friend tonight, Glacial Lake Columbia. This lake from this ice dam, this lake from this ice dam, the Okanagan Lobe right next to the Grand Coulee. And this has been carefully mapped. So Glacial Lake Columbia had many different sizes through time. It wasn't always high elevation water. But this is the biggest that Glacial Lake Columbia got. And here's the Sunset Highway. So you can see that it's very, very close. And then especially when we get to Spokane and Coeur d'Alene and even to Kellogg, we've got Glacial Lake Columbia water backing up from Okanagan Lobe. More images. This from Bruce Bronstad's excellent book, which I'll tell you about in a second. Montana, Washington, you've got the concept now. And the importance of Glacial Lake Columbia. So when this water is breaking through the ice dam in northern Idaho, it's plowing into an existing lake. I've already said that a couple times, but to me, that's a big message from tonight. And that Glacial Lake Columbia protected this area from damaging erosion, at least during some of these big floods. By the way, the last big Ice Age flood to come through central Washington was the breakup of the Okanagan Lobe itself. So we don't have this lake anymore. because we finally had this Okanagan lobe break into pieces, and that last major flood came over Wenatchee, came down the Columbia River Valley. But the timing of these two stories is worth looking at. And the timing of the deposits in Missoula and also along the shores of Lake Roosevelt are worth looking at. So look at how obvious this is. I hope this is obvious to you. Here's a map. Cheney, Reardon, Davenport, Wilbur, we're following the Sunset Highway. There's farming here, there's not here. There's farming here, there's not here. Why? The soil was washed away. Why? Glacial Lake Columbia was here. We overspilled on the south side of Glacial Lake Columbia, here and here. All the soil got swept away by the floods. Up high, a friend likes to fly and take video for us. So we're flying over a place that was not hammered by the floods. But look at how sheer we break off the leading edge of that. And so this is a flood path. This is a place where Glacial Lake Columbia leaked to the south. That's the concept we want. Those are the channeled scablands, if you're waiting for that. Great artistic image here of all sorts of things. But in general, we're looking at the big, thick pile of basalt lavas below ground. Below that, these ancient rocks that were buried by the lavas. And then with the lavas were buried in general by these rolling hills of loess that were then sporadically removed by these spillovers from Glacial Lake Columbia, ultimately triggered by the Missoula floods. You get the idea now, right? Channeled scablands, exposed basalt, exposed by the Ice Age floods, spilling south from Glacial Lake Columbia. So if this is new to you or you really want to work out the details, this book two of this two-volume set is excellent. On the Trail of the Ice Age Floods, The Northern Reaches by Bruce Bjornstedt and his former advisor at Eastern Washington University, Gene Kiever. Highly recommend it. More maps from that particular volume. Sunset Highway again. Good landmark for us. You can see the details. This is just a river valley with water in it. Here's the Spokane River coming in and the Columbia River coming in. And by the way, there's all sorts of timing issues. This ice is up here. The ice advances south. It comes back north. The Okanagan is always on the move. That's why it's complicated. There's all these moving parts in the story. And my head hurts when I try to work that all out. I can't handle it. Eventually, if I think long enough, I might be able to. This is near downtown Spokane and deposits on the bottom of Glacial Lake Columbia. This is up the Hangman Creek, if you know that, just south of I-90. Over by the Grand Coulee, again, I'm peddling the idea, I think I've got it straight, that the major coulee formation is earlier in the Ice Age. And one way to convince you of that is that sitting in the floor of the upper Grand Coulee, north of Dry Falls, are many, many Glacial Lake Columbia sediments. In other words, Glacial Lake Columbia sat in the upper half, the northern half of the Grand Coulee, late in the game. The first guy to really work out a lot of the details of Glacial Lake Columbia was this guy, Brian Atwater, and some of you know that name from 2 weeks ago. He's the guy at the coast digging for the tsunami sand. Before he did that tsunami great earthquake story, he was here in Glacial Lake Columbia. And he counted 89 Missoula floods. That's his famous contribution from this area. 89, at least 89 Glacial Lake Columbia sediments indicating Missoula floods dumping into that lake. And these are his photos from 30 years ago now. Rhythmic sediments. These are all deposits underwater, under the water of Glacial Lake Columbia, along the modern Columbia River Valley and technically the San Poil arm, the tributary. So he was correlating beds to beds through northern Washington. And interestingly, he was the first guy to show that if you have a flood deposit from Montana and another flood deposit from Montana, what's this stuff in between? These are varves. These are annual deposits. These are like tree rings in the mud. You can count these summer, winter, and you can actually count years between major ice age floods. So he worked out the timing of this literally 30 years ago, and there's this kind of work with varved sediments and other kinds of deposits otherwise. So there's promise to really put a comprehensive story together, but we're not there yet. I'm not just saying that. I really am pretty up on it, and major questions involving Moses, Cooley, and others are still up in the air. Even Bjornstad has question marks in many places. This is the current paper that was just sent to me by Carl Lilquist 2 mornings ago from the Canadian geologists, who used not only Atwater's field sites. This is the Sandpoil River coming into the Columbia. Here's Grand Coulee Dam to get you oriented. You know where you are? Here's the Spokane River coming in from Spokane. So each of these black dots is where they boated up Lake Roosevelt, studied the sediments, tried to find some regional correlations, and these are the locations that they found this datable layer, plant fossils in a sediment layer that's 13,400 years ago, and then again, the dozens of floods sitting on top of that. So again, you can just, anybody can look at these and realize that something was happening again and again. There's a rhythmic look to these deposits in the bottom of Glacial Lake Columbia. We'll eventually figure it out. We'll eventually have the interpretation of all this. I think we're just in the middle of that, and you're getting that point by now, I hope. And you can take the high water mark, the true maximum level of Glacial Lake Columbia, of all the Glacial Lake Columbia formations, and realize that we had spillways coming to the south at many locations between Dry Falls and Spokane. More Glacial Lake Columbia sediments, we got it now. So we, even when you drive on I-90, that's not our topic tonight, you're driving through this country that was heavily impacted by major ice age flood paths coming south from Glacial Lake Columbia, and then if we put the Sunset Highway in, that's another transect for us that we can use. Okay, the rest of tonight is roads, okay? So if you had enough geology, you're in luck. The rest of our time is looking at the early part of the 20th century. The yellow is the Sunset Highway. The red is the Inland Empire Highway. Ellensburg is here. Lauderdale Junction. Let's do it. So this is a map from Wes Engstrom, a local historian in Liberty area, and he's the guy that turned me on to this Colocum Pass story. So here's the old map from 1913. Ellensburg, we're going to go up and over Colocum, drop to Malaga, work our way to Wenatchee, cross the bridge. Abandon that, Blewett Pass. I took the time to show Lauderdale Junction, Ellensburg, Kittitas, Colocum, Malaga. That's what it would have looked like. Think of the impact in our valley if we had that major road coming through and going up over Colocum. Would I-90 have then gone there? I don't know. This was my friend this summer. I had this in my car most of the summer, a book by Chuck Flood. Some of you have seen these series. This one on Washington Sunset Highway. So I haven't met Chuck before, but thank you for the inspiration to follow these paths. So let's do that using Chuck's photos and then me with a little spare time this summer following these old roads. So we're over at the Idaho state line. We're going to go east to west on the Sunset Highway. Even at the state line, there's old cafes. There's a Forest and Last Chance Tavern over there at the Idaho-Washington state line. We're approaching Spokane from the east. That's still there, the old motor coach lodge with the golden arches behind. We're following the Sunset Highway. We're approaching Spokane from the east. Some of these old buildings are still there. It's not that many decades ago. We finally get into downtown Spokane. And by the way, if you're following the Yellowstone Trail and your spouse has talked you into this long cross-country trip in 1923, this is your first city since Minneapolis. We get into downtown. The Davenport Hotel was there at the time. The Davenport now, the Davenport back then. Downtown Spokane. And this is where the Sunset Highway went through. And here's where we visit with Bing Crosby, a Gonzaga law student back in the 1920s. This is Bing and the drums. He became famous as a singer, young people. Here's Al Rinker on the piano. They had a band that they played through much of high school and college. This is the actual passage in that book I was talking about their trip across the Cascades to Seattle. I went and recently found that old book. It's still there on the shelves. This is a replica or something I found on the internet that's a 1916 model. So it wasn't brand shiny new for Bing and Al. It was the band car. They used it 12 years after it was made. So Al tells us the story firsthand in the 1970s when they interviewed him. So downtown Spokane, Bing Crosby, we got the theater, great. Here's an old beautiful garage from the Art Deco period, I assume. And so let's do the journey with these guys. Let's leave Spokane. This is the Sunset Highway crossing Hangman Creek. Bridge is still there, beautifully constructed. Have you taken the time? This is just north of present-day I-90, and this old Sunset Highway is there, just to the west of downtown Spokane. And I was always fascinated by this really weird intersection. Again, we're just to the west of downtown Spokane, near a little neighborhood called Brown's Addition. And I was intrigued by this, with all this kind of old architecture. This was the junction of the Sunset Highway and the Inland Empire Highway, where they joined back before the Depression. And it's still part of the landscape there in Spokane. So today, when we drop into Spokane on I-90, this is our view coming down Sunset Hill. That's what the locals call it in Spokane. But this was the drop down to Spokane, heading to the east. Back in the old days. And the old sunset is still there. It's not as good looking as it used to be. If you look for it, the word sunset is all over the place along this old highway. Sunset flora, sunset road signs, etc. And up on top of Sunset Hill, we have these old, modern at the time, motels. They're still there, but have seen better days. So let's leave Spokane with Bing and Al. Davenport doesn't look a whole lot different today. Wilbur. Welcome to Wilbur. Those old welcome signs are still there. Elmira. I mean, these are towns that time forgot. I mean, there's really not a dramatic change to the look of these towns. That's what's so beautiful about Eastern Washington. Elmira again. Cooley City. By the time we get to Cooley City, we're approaching the Grand Coulee itself, the major spillway south from Glacial Lake Columbia. So let's pause and just remind ourselves that that's one of the major spillways coming from Glacial Lake Columbia, and Dry Falls was in eyesight of the Sunset Highway. I don't know if Bing and Al stopped there, but they could have. The ice itself, you can see, got right down to the Sunset Highway, but no further south, and that's why it's a convenient landmark for us. Here's Glacial Lake Columbia, and up coming up the Spokane River. So in the Grand Coulee itself, north of Dry Falls, all of this land are Glacial Lake Columbia sediments. Layer after layer of carpet, essentially, on the floor of that old glacial lake. And we can see the repetitive look. And again, I contend that this is kind of an afterthought. These are minor, delicate layers. If they were old, to me, they would have been easily removed by the next major flood coming down the Grand Coulee. But they're not. They're there. And they're delicate and they're well preserved. So if we look at Dry Falls area itself, obviously that's one of the most convenient places to be to understand the power of these Ice Age floods. And this is the most important spot in Eastern Washington to get the public to think about geology. And people have been pondering it for almost 100 years now at Dry Falls. We think of it today as Dry Falls, a place to stop and use the restroom on the way up to Grand Coulee Dam. But back in this day, it was a stop for our travelers going back and forth on the Sunset Highway. From the Wilford Woods Collection, one of my favorite shots. Some of you have been there. But even that, this old thing is still here. It's just like you're walking into a history book with many of these places in Eastern Washington. I'm not talking about geology. I'm just talking about human history. This is the Vista House, which is still there, the main interpretive site at Dry Falls State Park back in the day. Jim Gartrell right there. And back in the day, that site was the main spot to learn about this quote-unquote swollen Columbia River. There wasn't this talk about the Ice Age floods back at the time. J. Harlan Bretz was doing his work, but yes, nobody believed. It was J. Harlan Bretz, not Bing Crosby, doing the geology, right? And even today, last fall, we take groups up there, and it's hard to beat that view of all this massive Ice Age flood erosion from the Missoula floods. Our friend who flies, again, is up there. He's flying north. The visitor center at Dry Falls is over here. He's skimming over the top of Umatilla Rock. And he's going to continue flying until he gets on top of Dry Falls itself. Look at how much rock was removed. And I still don't think we're doing a good job helping people visualize what it was like. This is a 350-foot high cliff. And during big Missoula floods, there was 350 feet of water coming over this 350-foot cliff. So Niagara Falls is mentioned, but that's really not the way to visualize this. Look at how beaten up the top of Dry Falls is. We need a lot of water to hammer that landscape so dramatically. Continuing on with Bing and Al, we're now across the floor of Moses Cooley, a significant mystery that remains. Waterville, the town of Waterville. I love Waterville, still looks about the same. Leave Waterville, we're about to head down to Arondo. This is the old Sunset Highway, this is the new road. They had a big rock slide here this winter crossing this road, but this is the old Sunset Highway dropping to the Columbia River. Y'all with me? You know where we are? We're heading down to Wenatchee. Here's the old bridge built in 1908, the main road leading to that bridge. The bridge was built in 1908, but it's still there. Can you imagine our Model T, putt, 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 Bing and Al, on their way to Seattle, Sunset Highway. We cross to Wenatchee. We're now coming up the Wenatchee River. Kashmir. The old Sunset Highway goes right through downtown Kashmir. And we're going to leave Wenatchee, go up to Kashmir, Dryden, Bing and Al are going to hang a left. They're going to follow the Sunset Highway up and over Blewett Pass. This is a geology map, by the way. Everything in purple was under Ice Age flood water. The yellow stars are ice-rafted erratics that floated in on those blocks of ice and were perched along the high water mark. This is mountain ice coming out of the Cascades. So there's lots going on that intersects the Sunset Highway. Approaching the base of Blewett Pass now, even some human history there on the old stretch of the Sunset. Now, I love this photo. This was taken 1 year after Bing and Al did the climb. So here we go. We're approaching Blewett Pass, the old Blewett Pass. And that road is still there. It's paved. It's got a center stripe on it, but it was not paved when Bing and Al went over it. I'm not a mechanic, but I was told that some of these old vehicles, as they approached the summit, had to go up backwards. They had to put in reverse and go up to prevent some kind of lockup or something like that. I'm sure somebody will tell me about it after the lecture. Also, up at the old Blewett Pass, there were logs available. And you sometimes would chain the log behind your Model T or whatever your old vehicle was because your brakes couldn't do a good enough job keeping you under control. So you're dragging this log down the other side. So it was an adventure, is my point. And by the way, these roads were not open in the wintertime until the 1930s. So you just couldn't drive these roads over Blewett or Snoqualmie. And there were big local parties to go up and shovel the road to get the road open so we can get business to these towns. So with all that going on, I can't believe many people were stopping to look at the rocks. But of course we do. This is a big trip we did last fall and people were collecting plant fossils. And I told the Bing Crosby story there, and I guess people kind of understood what I was saying. So in case you know Blewett Pass, I'm not talking about the one that you know. I'm talking about the old Blewett Pass, a much windier road, more than 200 switchbacks. The stories I've heard from old-timers who did that road with their family, they would get car sick. It was constant, all these switchbacks. It was a nasty pass. They should have done Kalakum. That would have been the way to go. But of course, it was a landmark. You were just waiting to cross this thing. And so Blewett Pass was an important part on this journey. And there was an old lodge up at Blewett Pass, top of the hill inn, to stop and have a meal and maybe stay the night. It burned in the 1920s. On the Kittitas County side, Echo Point, one of these narrow switchbacks that looks like this today. As last week, if you were with us, we were talking about the role of the Tianaway basalt dikes that were feeding the surface. And I mentioned quickly last week that many of these switchbacks where people are vomiting on the corners, those switchbacks are controlled by where these dikes are. These are resistant walls of basalt bedrock, which made it difficult to get that pass through. There are stretches today of the old Sunset that look probably very similar to the way they did back then. Liberty. Liberty, Washington, known for gold. But the Sunset Highway is coming right through this area. People are doing placer gold mining right next to the old Sunset. So this Sunset Highway route that Bing Crosby and Al Rinker took is intersecting so much of this interesting geology, and that's the thing that I'm trying to convince you of tonight. By the time we get down to Lauderdale Junction, it's worth pausing. But before we do that, I want to publicly thank some of the folks that helped me with this lecture. I'm not a trained historian by any means. I just have an interest. And so a number of people helped me put these clues together. This guy, Wes Engstrom, lives in Liberty. He's the authority on Liberty area human history in his house. He's got microfiche and all this stuff to kind of go through these old articles. So he was a great help. Thank you, Wes. He's got all these wonderful volumes that made it easy for me. And he has written a number of books that he gives to family and friends to put lots of this together. So he helped me and took me on a drive, actually, one hot summer afternoon to retrace the old Sunset through the Liberty area over to Cleellum. And this is from Wes's book. Here, do you know where we're talking about? Lauderdale Junction, sometimes known as Viridon. If you don't, picture driving north out of Ellensburg. This is US 97. You come to a stop sign. People are driving way too fast from Seattle. They're coming in from the left. They're going to their third home in Chelan. So this is where 970 and 97 come together. This is the intersection we're talking about, but the old intersection is off of the modern intersection. The old intersection is here of the Sunset Highway and the Inland Empire Highway. Again, an important junction back in the day. Today's Lauderdale Junction doesn't go through there. But if you take the time to get off there and look around, there's only a couple buildings to look at. This lodge still stands. It's a private home now, so I didn't want to bother them. But the private home still has the architecture of the Lauderdale Lodge. The old Lauderdale School, or the Verdon School, is still there. Also a private home. They know it was an old school. And let's just take a moment before we complete the journey and hopefully we'll have some sound for the video at the end here. This is the Inland Empire Highway. Let's just do a couple of quick slides getting away from the Sunset. This is not Bing and Allen. So this is leaving Lauderdale Junction and heading south through Horse Canyon. And these old posts from the glory days of the Inland Empire Highway. And we're going to go right through the Blue Agate Fields. So if you stop and look around in some of those fields back in the day, the potential is to look for these gorgeous blue agates that are along the Inland Empire Highway. Take those blue agates and polish them up real good, you got something to keep. Ellensburg looked different back then, of course. It looked very different at the intersection of Main Street and University Way, formerly known as 8th Avenue. But if we continue, yes, it's the old Durr Road that the locals know. That was the original path of the Inland Empire Highway. If you wanted to head down to the Tri-Cities by car, you went up over this old stagecoach road. And again, the old Durr Road looks pretty much the way it probably did back then. But in 1924, for the first time, they put the road through the Yakima River Canyon. And they paved it just a few years later. So the Inland Empire Highway then were suddenly in this beautiful meandering river canyon known as the Yakima River Canyon. But if you continue south, south of Yakima, they even have OIE, the old Inland Empire Highway, marked. And Ashel Curtis, a famous photographer, had an apple orchard in Sunnyside, so he took a bunch of beautiful photos along the old Inland Empire Highway. Couple quick things before we go back to finish our journey. By 1931, we've got the bridge advantage. We've got traffic coming from Quincy down Frenchman Coulee, crossing the Columbia River on a bridge. And so obviously Ellensburg was affected by that. These are guys waiting for the ferry. So this has to be before 1927 at Vantage, where they would ferry your car across the river. So that's why I'm confident Bing and Al did not come through Ellensburg. They weren't going to wait for the ferry. They had a nice paved-in section Sunset Highway. But back in 27, they built that beautiful bridge at Vantage. It's not the bridge that's there now. This bridge that was built in 1927 was moved in the early 60s down on the Snake River. That's a whole other story for another day. In case I ever do another one of these lectures with old highways, I'm not sure how this is going over. But to put the road then through Frenchman Coulee, we've got to get a road through there. That was a feat unto itself. And to get the road then, so many old timers remember the old road, not the Sunset Highway, but the old road coming down into Frenchman Coulee and then crossing Advantage. This is from the Frederick Kruger collection up at Central's Library, some old home movies shortly after that new bridge at Vantage. I love the dresses. I'm thinking late 20s, early 30s, but what do I know? We got to keep with it. The gals are going to walk in some sand dunes in high heels and dresses. There we go. Great. Wonderful. So by 33, we've got a few more roads. By 1939, it's starting to look more and more familiar. Still no interstate yet. By 1950, we've even got more. Well, now we've got U.S. roads. We've got U.S. 10, we've got U.S. 97. We're getting closer and closer to the era that we all know and love. Remember now, the Yellowstone Trail was the national trail, a single road until you get to Washington. And before 1925, the Inland Empire, after the Sunset Highway, maybe it's a dealer's choice, I'm not sure. And there was a logo that was used to keep people on the trail. So this is, there's one of these up at Snoqualmie Pass still on the old Yellowstone, the old Sunset Highway, essentially. There's a few others that are scattered across the country. I had to include this. My own family has a story of a person driving to Hollywood. This is my grandpa, who was on the dairy farm in Wisconsin, the family farm, and he felt the walls of his life closing in, apparently, and he could sing. So he took off in a car, didn't take the Yellowstone Trail, but he went to Hollywood. He was exactly the same age as Bing Crosby. So they were both in Hollywood at about the same time, and my grandpa went back home a couple of years later. His dad needed to get off the farm, and so he went back to Wisconsin. I'm grateful that he did. That's where I'm from, on that farm. But postcards from back in the day sent home about how great Hollywood was. All right, let's get back to finishing our journey. So Bing and Al, Thursday, October 15th, 1925, Liberty, Lauderdale Junction, the old road to Cleellum. Get ourselves towards Snoqualmie Pass. Once we get up to Cleellum, we've got the old sandstones of the Swauk Formation. These are photographs from the Fred Krueger collection. Beautiful old photographs. I just snapped these right off of his computer monitor. So Fred used to teach high school in the Cleellum area. He's another guy that helped me. So I visited him in Rosewood here in Ellensburg, and he spent an afternoon helping me flesh out this lecture. So thanks to Fred for his help and some of his beautiful old photographs from his collection, which is beautiful and rich and available to many up at Central's Library. And then of course I have to include Yvonne Prater, who was is most well known. She's a local, was a local gal, was best known for her book about the history of Snoqualmie Pass. It's still a very bestseller for the mountaineers. And Yvonne was working on another book about the old Blewett Pass. And so I invited her to visit with me last summer, and I showed her some of my photos, etc., and she was very encouraging, and passed away just a couple of weeks after that. So thank you to Yvonne. Up and over Snoqualmie Pass, the Sunset Highway, we crossed the pass. They opened this road in 1915, paved decades later, and we dropped down the old Sunset Road. This is Bing and Al now. North Bend, where are we? North Bend, Snoqualmie, Snoqualmie Falls, Falls City, Preston, Issaquah. So this is the old Sunset Highway crossing the river above Snoqualmie Falls. And then the final leg is to get us to Issaquah. There's no way to get across Lake Washington in 1925, so we've got to follow the Sunset Highway through the Issaquah Alps to Renton, work our way down, present-day Pacific I-5, used to be Pacific Highway, get into the Rainier Valley, and get themselves to a few paying gigs in downtown Seattle. So here's our hero for tonight, Bing Crosby in his early days. Do we have sound for the first movie appearance of not only Bing, but Al, both making it on the silver screen 2.5 years after their journey?
Without a doubt, Spec, that suit is going to put Ripstitch on the map.
Cinch.
Hey, fellas, This is a great time to sing that parody about Ripstick.
Great idea.
When a fellow needs a friend, call on dear old Ripstick. When he needs a 5 or 10, he never turned a tape man down.
Oh, Ripstick.
And when we are feeling blue, who is Dr. Ripstick? Daddy of a mother, he never turned a tape man down.
For a coat, for a vest, for a coat or the best.
So Bing and Al were part of the Rhythm Boys. They got hooked on with Paul Whiteman and his national touring band, and within by 1933, Al is discarded. It's Bing Crosby, the star of the show, and he's hit the big time. And the rest is history. Thanks, everybody, for coming tonight. Appreciate it.